And out of that came this idea of the so-called minimum ton. Imagine this, a barrel, fantastic barrel with staves that are of different length. You see that some are very long, some are medium size, some are very short. And if this would be a barrel that is supposed to be the vessel to contain the kingship of Christ over you, I'm not even saying over your church, because it has never been your church in the first place, so why would I even talk about this? But let's talk about your city or your region. So let's look at these levels. If that were you, and if the living water of Christ through the Holy Spirit would be poured into this vessel, you all know what happens. You can pour the fullness of the Holy Spirit into this vessel, but it will only be able to contain as what? As much as the lowest little stave. In other words, you can pour and scream, Holy Spirit, fill me, Holy Spirit, do this, Holy Spirit, do that. If your lowest stave, whatever that may be, is low, then that's all you will contain. One of my friends is Christian Schwarz, he's a German church growth man, and he went around the whole world and with the 8 signs of a growing church that he inherited, I think, from Peter Wagner. And I remember there was a time, and still is, through the natural church development movement, where they were identifying for a classical church, a Sunday morning church. I call this a staged church. 8 characteristics. To define those 8 staves, it was, what was it? Empowering leadership, gift-oriented ministry, passionate spirituality, functional structures, inspiring worship services, holistic small groups, need-oriented evangelism, and loving relationships. And so you could almost diagnose your church and then find out what's the lowest stave and then work at the stave and then kind of raise it a millimeter and then you have a revolution. Because if you have a stave that is very long, where you're very strong at, let's say you think you're very strong at worshiping, and then you lengthen that stave another kilometer. Exactly how much more God can fit into the barrel? Zilch, nothing, not one drop. And that's the situation actually of a lot of churches or ministries. They keep on doing what they think they're good at doing, and they don't recognize that the presence of God, the Shekinah, the Emmanuel factor, the fact that God actually lives there and just doesn't come for a little visit, is negligible. I remember I finished writing the Starfish Manifesto one day, and I looked at that psalm word where it says, if the Lord doesn't build a house, the workers build in vain. And I defined 2 ways of building the house of God. One is the man's way, and one is God's way. Some of you may have read that. And I said that when men build, it is always according to patterns taken from earth, not from heaven, where we men take the initiative, let's do it, who will join? And usually such a project actually never finishes, and so on and so forth. But when God does, it's always according to a blueprint taken from heaven, where he chooses the people, and he brings them together. And when the stuff is finished, actually God moves in. Now that's amazing. And I've been in so many different churches where basically all they did was to build an amazing structure for this one thing that a prophet would say, I see the Lord walk through these rows and pews, and he's touching a person over here, and he's touching a person over there, and sing that song, just a touch of the Lord. I find it so disgusting, because that's not why Christ came, to touch you and then leave because it stinks of smelly socks and who knows what else. He wants to move in. And I remember I was in a conference of a Lutheran leadership conference somewhere in Europe, and a man was there who is famous because he written a book about Come Holy Spirit. And I asked him, have you ever thought about the principles that we need to have in place that would communicate to God, stay Holy Spirit? And he looked at me and said, I don't understand the question. And I said, you're quite right. And that's not my main message. I was thinking about this, and I'm going to bring out something that's going to be called the Kingdom Plumb Line. So that's not my theme tonight. I just use this as a way of introducing a subject. If this were the kingdom, if this would be a kingdom vessel, it would be you. Let's talk about you and me. What would be the staves that would be important for you to contain as much kingship and as much kingdom as possible? Would it be a goal-oriented pastor? Would it be holistic small groups? You know what? I don't think it needs any of those, because we're still talking about staged religion. Let me run down very quickly, very briefly, the eight things that I feel that God would say, these are the staves that you really, really need. And this would come after you would respond to a message like the one that Mercy just gave you. It begins with your own death. If you cannot pray, your kingdom come, my kingdom go, you've understood nothing of the kingdom. And therefore, what do we then do? So many people talk about kingdom, but what exactly do we do? What does this mean? And I believe it means quite simply eight different things. And I'm just really running through them to get to my actual subject, which is the Constitution, of course. The very first thing without which you go nowhere in the kingdom is humble submission. I will always give you just two words, humble submission. If you cannot humbly submit to the kingship of Christ, where he is the king and you are the dom, then you haven't understood what a kingdom is. Humble submission. This is what it is. The second one is loving obedience. If you love me, you keep my commandments. Loving obedience. Forced obedience will be Islam. Loving obedience, that is the kingdom. You want to obey. Number three, selfless sharing. Because that's actually the heart of kingdom economics. He selflessly shared, not sold himself. Selfless sharing. That's the heart of kingdom economics. And number four, that will be then an apostolic life. That means a life that has been sent forth, not just stumbling forward, make itself important. An apostolic life. How apostolic is your life? How sent is it? Number five, holy fear. I was just together with a guy who runs the website Holy Fire. And I said, have you ever heard of holy fear? Everybody wants holy fire. Who shivers before his word? Who understands that God is going to judge as well, because he is a judge? And is going to be a bailiff of God when things are going to happen that nobody can explain, and no minute of silence and no amount of candles that we light will be able to explain? God is in the midst of doing these things. And if he doesn't have people who understand that, he will search some people and find. The sixth one would be trusting oneness. Trusting oneness. And the seventh one would be thankful passion. And the last one would be prophetic discernment. I just would like you to at least hear it once, that if I look at church today, I see almost everywhere the exact opposite. In all sorts of nice spiritual clothing, I see the opposite of humble submission. And if you just once briefly entertain the thought, what's actually the opposite of what we're talking here? It would be proud leadership. It would be selfish rebellion. It would be egoistic hoarding instead of selfless sharing. Instead of apostolic life, it would be domesticated routine. Instead of holy fear, it would be stubborn opinionatedness. Instead of trusting oneness, it would be faithless individualism. Instead of thankful passion, it would be embittered professionalism. And instead of prophetic discernment, it would be reactionary blindness. Where do we go from here? I find it absolutely fascinating that when Jesus came to this earth, he came into a world and visited a people to whom God himself, his Father, had already offered his kingship. I remember starting the Kingdom Manifesto saying lots of people have dreams about God. What actually does God dream about us? And I go on to say that three things. He dreams about three things. He wants to move in. He wants to live amongst us. Walk before me, Abraham, and be truthful. That's what he wants. He wants to walk with us. In the garden, he started. The second thing is he wants to marry us. Marry the bride. He wants to marry a bride, not a bitch. Let me just underline that. Someone who runs anywhere and just is with anybody except the king. And thirdly, he wants to be our king. And those three things, all three of them, have been violently denied to God by his own people. Adam and Eve, they broke the tree law thing, got kicked out of the garden. Later on, in a conversation with Samuel, God says they have rejected me to be their king at this time, and they basically choose their own king and call him Saul. Deuteronomy 28, God says to his people, if you keep my law, I will bless you. If you break my law, I will curse you. And so on. If you take this idea that God will bless those who obey him, Peter was just speaking about the nature of blessing, and I said somewhere else that the word blessing, like the Hebrews like this word games, barak in Hebrew with a K at the end means knee, and barak with a Q at the end means lightning. And the concept is quite simple. If something is on its knees, symbolizing obedience to its creator, then the lightning of God shall hit that creature. And if lightning hits you, you receive an energy upgrade, right? It turns you into you 2.0. And it does something to you that only God can confer and transfer. And that is exactly the essence of the kingdom. God, yes, gives us his love and his grace free of charge without any conditions. But his blessings are absolutely conditional, whether you like it or not, whether you have heard this or not. It is like that. That's a decree. Which means that if we are not on our knees, that we are not obedient to the decrees and laws of God, he will be unable to bless us as much as he loves us. And so we will run around with charismatic grace gifts, but never enter into this thing that the New Testament called exousia, legal, official power that is delegated by the throne itself to people who have sworn an oath of allegiance to the king and his constitution, just like every other country in this world does it like that. Enter kingdom. It's the same story. So when Jesus came, I find it quite fascinating, he came into a situation where the Jews had completely messed up that whole original idea and dream that God actually had with his people. And he came into this world not at all saying, I am here to start a new religion. Far from it, he came to save us from a religion. Jesus started a country. When he spoke about the kingdom, that's exactly what it is. How can you be a king without a dom? He started a country. He even appealed to those local political ideas, like when a new emperor was chosen. He was usually chosen in such a way that the gods would endorse the guy by the eagles landing on him, and therefore the augurs, these pagan priests who say that we can see something in the ways that the birds fly, would say the eagle has landed on Caesar, therefore he is our new Caesar, right? When Jesus was baptized, no eagle landed. A dove landed on him. And everybody knew that somebody is being inaugurated here. It's a political message. Because Jesus didn't come to start a church. He started a country. If you want to serve a country, no one in any country will give you any office, not even a water gun, if you don't swear an oath of office. If you don't swear that you will be loyal to the Constitution and to the president or king of that country. Try it out. Walk up to London Bridge or wherever, or to Germany, Berlin, or wherever you come from, and say, I slept in the flag tonight. I feel all nationalistic. Please give me all the state secrets and the money and the atomic bombs. They will laugh you out the window. Why? Because you're not dependable. You just say things. How do we know you're loyal? Do we know that you're really loyal to the Constitution? You probably don't even know it. So therefore, in every government, every single policeman, military man, spy, judge, member of parliament has to swear an oath of allegiance. And if you look at it, it's a transfer of ownership. When you swear that oath of allegiance, you are not a private person any longer. You cannot do what you want, when you want, if you want, with whom you want. That's why you are in office, an officer. And if not, you're not. Enter kingdom. It's the same story. Jesus demonstrated this, that he took such an oath of office. Basically, this is when he says, not my will be done. And of course, the idea of baptism, life as I know it is over. Even that is not enough. It's going to be tested whether it's just your word or whether you are actually for real. And Jesus was tested by the worst teacher they could come up with, who really are going to test whether this is about him, whether he's going to use the things that God gave him, even the charismatic gifts, for his own advantage, or whether he's truly serving a larger constituency that he calls the will of the Father. It is written. That's the codex to which he was bound. And that tester was the devil himself. You know, the famous test in the desert. You know that. Where it was all about, do you trust God for his provision, or do you make things happen yourself? Do you trust God for your fame when you jump off the precipice of the temple and the cameras are running? Or do you go on the ground, so to speak? Do you deny that offers that are going to come any one's way that the devil can make to people that are too good to refuse? Or will you go the way of the cross in order to become part of the kingdom? And so Jesus came and said all these things, and the Jews didn't really understand a word of what he's saying, because they were so much into when will God finally come down to establish the kingdom to Israel, what his disciples are still asking in Acts 1:6. And basically Jesus answers quite interesting, none of your business, not at this moment. So Jesus quite clearly comes and brings an entirely different, unexpected message that is not religious at all. Peter was already saying that three of the crucial words in the New Testament, Greek words, are not religious. They were hijacked by the religious people. One of them is ecclesia itself, and it means parliament or government. We already had that. The second word is exousia. Exousia doesn't mean religious power. It means official legal power that is given to people who have sworn an oath of office to an existing constitution that they did not write. We love our own statutes and bylaws, and every church and ministry I know has their own mission statement and vision statement and laws and bylaws in there. How's it called? The faith statement. We believe that when the Holy Spirit comes, we'll fall all forward. No, we fall all backward. I hate that stuff. I was once asking some conference, Wolf, what do you think? Should we fall backward? Should we fall forward? I said, I don't care which way you fall. What I care is what you do when you get up. And so the whole concept is that we are in this absolute selfish bubble we have created with religious laws and traditions around ourselves, and we call it church. And we say, God, visit us. And sometimes he may come, and it smells like hell. And he just the touch of the Lord, because that's all he can afford. Otherwise, he's out of here. Because so many things are not right. So many pink elephants are in the room, and he says, where do I even start? Do I start with humble submission? My wife, Mercy, has just finished a book called The King's Woman. It's a fantastic love story of the universe where God, that the story has been described, how God is chasing after her, how God is loving her, how God is after this woman that he wishes to be his woman, and she just would not. Whatever he did, she wouldn't submit. She didn't want him to be ruled. She wanted to be ruled by anybody except him. She was a bitch, a real bad one. Even in a correctional facility called Babylon, she really wasn't corrected. She always mixed up things. She was a split personality. She split into Samaria and in Judea. They fought each other, these two personality aspects. It was an amazing story. If you look at the whole history from that perspective, that it's after all about a woman and a marriage. And then came the church. And guys and girls, they did exactly the same thing. The church did exactly every single aspect, every single thing that the Jewish have done, the church has done as well. Very helpful. That's why I think we need to listen to Bob Hopkins one more time, who said, stop starting with the church. And I came to say to you, I believe we need to hear a new message. Number two, I think we need to prepare ourselves to be a good ground for that message, and to bring forth fruit. And when we are that ground, then God is going to sow messages in us, seeds, kingdom seeds, that will do something to us. What if God would wish to plant a number of kingdom seeds in you, into you right now? Would you be ready? What if you were this, And God wants to fill you with the presence of the King and then rule through you, through the presence of the kingdom, and wants to do the same thing in your region. What would be your lowest state? What would it be? This is where I would start if I were you. Would it be humble submission? Everything in this world screams about egalitarianism. We want to be like God. Women want to be like men. And nowadays, by the way, men want to be like women. So nobody knows what. So the whole idea is egalitarianism, whatever it is. Nobody wants to submit to anybody. And you know what? If we don't even model this in marriage, if we just, as Christians, copy what the world does, thinking they are the prophets, and we follow it, you know what? We will fall out of the entirely, out of the creational order of God, and we will not be blessable. Just as Christ submitted to his Father without him actually having to do that, voluntarily, humbly, he humbled himself, Philippians 2. That's why God has elevated him. And in the same way, we reflect this with our marriage. And friends, we either do it or we don't. We know so many marriages that are really not blessed. They're struggling. And if you look at it, one of the biggest reasons is they don't really... The man doesn't submit to Christ as king. He has a God, but no king. He wants to be saved, healed, and delivered, but please don't rule me. I'll do this myself. So how can such a man be blessed? He cannot. He can be loved. He can be showered with grace, but he cannot be blessed. And how about a woman that is not submitting to her husband as the head of the family because she read in some other book that she's actually the same and needs to prove to everybody else that we are the same? Don't listen to the spirit of our time. Listen to the spirit of the Holy God, and you shall be blessed. So therefore, I invite you to allow God to place that seed, that kingdom seed of humble submission into you. Would you be ready to receive that? And the second thing is about loving obedience. It's amazing when I did my own little research about the Constitution, how it was an insight came to me that I basically thought that whole stuff about the law of Christ has been completely robbed from Christianity. It's completely gone. When you ask any Christian anywhere, the main thing you get is confusion, complete confusion. Some people think we need to still circumcise, to keep holy feasts, to have the Sabbath, to not have the Sabbath, to keep the Ten Commandments, to not keep the Ten Commandments, to keep no commandments, to keep the two commandments, to keep whatever commandments you like, to keep the commandments that you like and underline in the Bible. Some people call it like the fifth gospel. You know, the fourth were written by these guys and the fifth one was underlined by you. I choose this, I like this, but I don't like that. Listen to this couple verses. Then I draw this to a close. When Jesus was coming, he said, I give you a new law. Whoever loves me keeps my laws. Stay in my love that enables you to keep my commands. John 15:9. You are my friends if you do what I command you. He's a commander. If you want to go into life, keep the commandments. Whoever listens to my words and does them is like one that builds his house on rock. If, however, someone does only hear it but doesn't do it, he builds on sand and without foundation. Blessed those that are hearing the word of God and keep it. Teach all nations to obey what I have commanded you. If Jesus is not good enough for that, how about John? He says, how do we know that we love him and know him when we keep his commandments? Who is the his in the his commandments? He's not talking about the law of Moses. He's talking about the law of Christ. He says, who says I know him but doesn't keep his commands is a liar, 1 John 2:4. He says, whoever oversteps the teaching of Jesus Christ and isn't faithful in it doesn't have God. And he even quotes again in Revelations 22:14, blessed are those who keep his commands. And let's just finish it with Paul. Paul himself says, I am not without the law before God, but I am under the law of Christ. 1 Corinthians 9:21. I found very few people who have actually underlined this in their fifth gospel version. He speaks about, we have received from him grace and apostleship to establish the obedience of faith amongst all people in his name. So it's all about obedience as well. And he says, the oversteppers of the law, will not inherit the kingdom of God. Help each other to carry each other's loads or burdens. That's how you fulfill the law of Christ. I once went on the internet and tried to search, did anybody ever do this actually? To take this serious, and when Jesus says, teach them to obey everything what I have commanded you. So what is this everything? So I went online, I went through all sorts of lists, and I literally found not one serious book that was actually doing that. And looking at it from the perspective that this is actually the law of Christ that he established, the dikaiosune, what Peter already mentioned, the Greek word in Matthew 6:33, that is wrongly translated, seek you first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That's not what dikaiosune is. It's literally a body of law that a group of people give themselves to live by. And this is a law that is given by God to his people. In other words, your opinion and my opinion about this is not invited. Welcome to the kingdom. It doesn't need your opinionatedness. No, it doesn't. And if you submit yourself to that, if this is the first thing that you seek, then everything else shall be added unto you. And so little things are actually added to so many people that I see. Why is that? It's because the stave of legality in the kingdom is extremely low. I would say it's almost non-existent in the body of Christ. Recently, a young man came up to me and says, Wolf, I want so badly to obey Christ, but I feel like a guy that wants to drive a car on the road and I don't know what the road signs actually say. Do I drive 50 here, 80, 120? I don't know. What do? I went out and found a guy who is an artist and a surfer from Michigan. He did an attempt on it. He tried to come up with a book on the law of Christ, and I thought, a surfer on this, that's cool. No theologian that I know ever did this. Calvin tried to rule Geneva with his own institutes, not with the law of Christ. The idea of a constitution as a legal framework between a king and his people hasn't even been existing. It was invented, politically speaking, by Immanuel Kant, a German philosopher, in the 1790s. And then, of course, the Americans and their constitution. But now, we know what a constitution is, and almost every country has one. And so when you want to work for a government, everybody knows what it means to swear an oath of allegiance for a constitution. So I went at it and basically discovered that that work seemingly has not really been done. So let me do it myself. And I started to write down the constitution of the kingdom of God, taking all the 384 do's and don'ts that Christ has, the so-called Jesuanic imperatives that you find in the Greek New Testament, and when you take out all the doublets from the various Gospels, when you take out those commands where he says, go wash yourself in the pool of Bethesda, or Satan, go behind me, these are not commands you run a country with. But if you read them all out, then what you get at the end of the day, if you're really sober and systematic about it, you get 75 commands of Jesus Christ. I looked at it many, many different times, and I decided, all right, let's do this. To actually speak about this, talk about this. I've written a book about it. It's going to come out in German in 5 days. But I brought you a little token. We decided to bring it out as a poster so that people can have it. And I find it amazing what happens when people start to have that poster in their church or in their office. Suddenly it becomes real. Suddenly it becomes something very specific. Just like Jesus, whom I once described as probably the most polarizing guy on the planet. He appeared and he drew a line in the sand and he said, from now on, there are two kinds of people, those who are with me and those who are not. Choose. Let me finish this with a very fascinating prophetic statement that we find in the Bible. I remember Mercy once received this a couple of years ago. It was about the Malachi prophecy. I call it the Malachi list. In Malachi, the last prophet of the Old Testament, just before God entered almost like 400 years of thundering silence with his people, because he just absolutely wouldn't listen. And those who worked for God could not live off it, because the rich are called blessed, and those who want to work for God are basically fools. That's the situation that was there at the end of Malachi. And in that situation, where God was almost ready to go home, there is this statement. And by the way, let me bring in, and I'm not going to be too long, so don't worry. Mercy and I, we are a team. And so she often is the one that gets the prophetic downloads, and I ponder now, what in the world do we do with this? Because we have to digest this, and as a couple, we want to mirror this and live this. And once she was taken in a place in heaven, she doesn't often have that, but she was taken in a place, and that was like a throne room, and God was discussing something with a few people, and they were in a corner, and Mercy, for some reason, was entering this throne room somewhere unexpectedly. And God was looking around at her and almost looking at her annoyed and said, "What do you do here?" And it was obvious that this was about Europe. And she answered him, "The blood of Christ makes me righteous before you, and that's why I'm here." And it calmed him down. But then God the Father said something very, very stern. He says, "My people," and he spoke about Europe, "my people, they love me. They worship me. They do all sorts of things in my name. They do all sorts of things for me. But they don't obey me. And that's why I cannot give them what I want to give them. Is there anybody in Europe who actually obeys me, on whom I can count? Who is legal in my kingdom?" That's my translation. "Who is keeping my commandments?" I know very few people in Europe who even know more than 3 or 4 commands of Christ itself. How can you keep all of them if you don't even know them? And so I felt something needs to happen in this dimension. And let me close this with the Malachi list. Just before this amazing darkness starts, where God himself is silent, there is this word where it says, "You have said harsh things against me, says the Lord, yet to ask, what have you said against you? You have said, it is futile to serve God. What did we gain by carrying out his requirements and going about like mourners before the Lord Almighty? But now we call the arrogant blessed. Certainly the evildoers prosper, and even those who challenge God escape." In such an amazing situation, after all these centuries where God has tried to get to her, to marry her, to get her understand that he wants to live in, move in, rule her, and be her king and be together with her. Then in that situation, an event is being prophesied that hasn't, in my understanding, happened so far. "Then those who feared the Lord talked with each other, and the Lord listened and heard." Because I think he had already switched off. "A scroll of remembrance was written in his presence concerning those who feared the Lord and honored his name. They will be mine, says the Lord Almighty. In the day when I make up my treasured possession, I will spare them, just as in compassion a man spares his son who serves him. And you will again see the distinction between the righteous," that is translated those who keep the law of Christ, "and the wicked, between those who serve God and those who do not." I think such an event is coming up. And maybe we are in a situation. A scroll of remembrance, by the way, if you don't know that, was a Persian tradition of the Persian kings. So when there was a particular issue or challenge with the country, then often the king would look for a group of people that he could absolutely trust. So he was kind of looking around, is there anybody in my country on whom I can rely? And they wrote a scroll of remembrance. It is a scroll that contains names, where people wrote down their names and basically gave it to the king and says, "You can rely on me." That is what a scroll of remembrance is. And if we were a government, such a scroll of remembrance cannot be written. You cannot enter your name if you are not ready to accept, humbly submit to Christ the King, and lovingly obey his commands. It just doesn't work. So the question is, would you be on that list? And let us look at the whole kingdom theme from this perspective, that we are holding ourselves up one more time to God and say, "I want to be a vessel, a chosen vessel, that contains as much king and kingship and kingdom as possible. Because if God doesn't rule me, if that doesn't work, if I'm like that woman that keeps running away from him, like we have these two women running around, one called Judaism, one called Christianity, both of them far away, I believe, from the king, then I would suggest to you, go at it and make it your homework. Make it your goal that you yield yourself to God and say, "Lord, lift me up. Sow these seeds into me. I want to be a good ground, a fertile soil. I want to quit all these yes and no's and ifs and don'ts, all these shallow excitements without really roots. I want to open myself and be that garden, be that field. Sow into me, and it be done to me as you say." And then he will sow into you What was it again? Humble submission, loving obedience, selfless sharing, and your life will turn into an apostolic life with holy fear, passionate oneness, and so on. And I really pray that that will happen to all of us. So while we are here, let's allow God to do exactly that and let Him take us to where this is going to take us.